वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग ऑल ऑफ यू। सो द टॉपिक टुडे इज पेस्ट ऑफ शुगर केन फॉर योर सेमिस्टर फिफ्थ एंड योर कोर्स ऑफ क्रॉप पेस्ट एंड देयर मैनेजमेंट। They are the field crops. In this, we have the crop sugarcane, wherein the enlisted names of the pests. Here we have 10 of them. First is the early shoot borer, second internal borer, third top shoot borer, fourth is white fly, fifth pyrilla, sixth woolly aphids, seventh mealybugs, eighth scale insect, ninth termites, and 10th white grub. So one by one we are going to see all these pests as per their feeding habit and as per their losses or damage to our sugarcane crop, which is a very important crop in the whole economy of our country and basically our state. Now the first pest here is the early shoot borer. As per the name suggests, it is early shoot borer. Scientific name, Chilo infiscatellus, family Pyrrellidae, order Lepidoptera. Now these two things you are much familiar with, the family and the order. So it is Lepidopteran. So the simple most assumption or fact that we may say is that the damaging stage of all such pests which are belonging to this Lepidopteran order is the larval stage. Got it? Always, whenever you are going to write your exams, if the nature of damage you are explaining, within that the damaging stage should be larvae. The economic importance, you can see the losses that you get or you have to bear, they are very in a big chunk. You are to lose up to 22 to 33% in your whole yield, and 12%, this is a random estimate that is said, in the recovery. So it is a big number. How you can identify this pest? The marks of identification are there. As you can see in the photograph, it is grayish brown or straw colored. The males are smaller than the females in case of these adults. Then the larvae, it is grayish in color, having dark head and translucent body with spot and hair on it. And a full grown larvae is 20 to 25 mm in length. And in between the photograph of the adult as well as the larvae, you can see some white specks in between. They are the eggs on the leaf. Now the host plants. So here this pest is a very crucial pest which attacks the cereals, jawar, maize, bajra, some millets, and the crop in question now, that is sugarcane. So life history, the oviposition is along the sides of midrib on the leaves. So oviposition site is on the leaves but along the sides of the midrib. Incubation period 3 to 6 days. Larval period after hatching is 22 to 31 days, means almost it can feed for 3 to 4 weeks in your field on your crop. Pupation is inside the stem, so it is feeding on the stem also, and it is entering the stem to pupate. Pupation period is 5 to 9 days. And the egg stage and pupal stage, these two stages are inactive stages. They are not going to cause any direct damage to our crop. And also the adult, but the adult is going to lay the eggs, so that we have to take care of. So life cycle is completed within 34 to 51 days. And as per this calculation, they will have 8 generations per year. So year round, this pest will be available in the field or in the whole agro ecosystem. The hibernation of this pest is seen in the larval stage, and it hides or it keeps itself safe in the stubbles of the leftover sugarcane after harvest. Then seasonal occurrence, active from July to September in Ardsali. All of you are knowing what Ardsali crop is. Whichever is planted in or from during the initiation of the monsoon, that is from June to August, you are getting this crop planted. In simple words, sowing is done. Then November and December in pre-seasonal planting, and January to March in Suru planting. Suru means the initiation of the year, that is Suru planting. Then moderately high temperatures with light rains and low humidity is responsible for the rise of this pest, that is the early shoot borer in the sugarcane. Now you can see here the pupa is on the lower side. You can see how it is pupating inside the stem, and the dead heart symptom, all of you are acquainted with this in rice. So this dead heart, what the pest is doing, it is injuring the young cane up to 8 weeks after planting. The caterpillars enters in the young shoot and makes holes just above the ground level and tunnels downwards. The central shoots dry up, causing dead heart, as you can see in the photograph. The sign, you may say the characteristic one of the presence of this pest within the plant, is the dead heart. Okay, so if you are having such a symptom of dead heart in your crop of sugarcane, you will say that surely it is early shoot borer. The dead heart can be easily pulled out. The central shoot is dried. It rots inside the stem and emits an offensive smell. If you have the dead heart out of its place, you may also see some larvae inside. And if you try to smell it, it gives very offensive smell. Very bad smell is there. The next pest is internode borer, that is Chilo saccharifagus indicus, family Crambidae, order Lepidoptera. The economic importance, high or a big yield loss is seen up to 34% and 0.06 to 4.2% recovery loss. All of you are, those who are in the sugarcane belt, they know this value of recovery. The marks of identification, moth is small, 10 to 12 mm in length. It is straw colored. Again, the four wings have marginal dark line and the hind wings are white. Caterpillars 20 to 23 mm in length, brownish in color and with some spots. Host plants, almost the group of grasses or the family of grasses, the wheat, paddy, maize, jawar, some grasses and sugarcane. Life history, here the oviposition is seen between the leaf sheath and the stem in clusters. Incubation period 4 to 9 days. Larval period 31 to 38 days, almost month and above. Pupation inside the stem in the larval tunnels. Then life cycle completed in 6 to 8 weeks with 5 to 6 generations in a year. The larvae overwinters in the canes or stubbles from November to February. Seasonal occurrence, throughout the year it is present, and infestation from May to September. Pest is mostly active during day and warm conditions. So the pupa you may see and the attack you can see or observe on the in the big photograph. So the nature of damage, infestation of the pest is noticed in all stages of crop growth. Neonate larvae feed on the leaf spindle or leaf sheath by scraping the tissues, and characteristic white streaks are seen on leaf lamina when it opens. You have the scraping and streak-like symptom on the leaf lamina. Then the larvae bore or enter inside later on into the tender cane top. The entry holes are plugged with excreta. So on enlarging this photo, you can see it bores in the cane's top. Okay, then excreta is released and it packs that hole or the entry gate. Then most of the borer attack is found in the top 5 immature internodes. In rattan crop, formative internodes are badly damaged, resulting in formation of dead hearts, which do not emit a foul smell when pulled out. And in case of early shoot borer, you get the foul smell. The larvae feed on the inner tissues and the frass is pushed out to the exterior, and such dirty appearance of that particular infested hole is observed. Due to feeding, galleries are formed inside the cane. The tissues turn red, leading to reddish appearance of the cane inside. The next pest is top borer or top shoot borer, Scarpophaga acceptalis, or Scarpophaga nivella as we also call it. Family Pyralidae, order Lepidoptera. Losses up to 55% in yield. Then moth is creamy white, female has orange colored tuft of hairs at the tip of abdomen. In the photograph we'll see it in the major scale next time. Then in certain males, each of the four wings have a black spot on the right and left side. Caterpillars are yellowish, 25 to 35 mm in length, means almost 2.5 to 3.5 centimeters in length, or 1 inch and more than that. Then the host plants, it may feed on jowar, rice, maize and other grasses along with sugarcane. Then the life history, it lays the eggs on the underside of leaves, incubation for 6 to 7 days, larval period of 3 to 6 weeks, means almost 1 month to 1.5 or 1.5 months it is going to feed on your crop. Then pupation inside the stem in the larval tunnels, pupal period is 7 to 10 days, and within 5 to 9 weeks it completes its one generation and leads to 6 generations in a year. Carryover, the full grown caterpillars hibernating in the cane tops in winter period. Seasonal occurrence, mostly in October, November they are observed, and in majority the Arsali crop. Here you can see the damage symptoms as they bore inside the leaves. The pest is injurious to the cane in later stages and persist till harvesting. The newly hatched caterpillar makes number of small holes on leaves, and we call it a short hole appearance or short hole symptoms on the leaves. Later on, they enter into the midrib of the leaf and produce galleries in the midribs. So this pest is causing damage to the leaves, and along with that, they are again causing damage to the canes. Then later, they bore downwards into the shoot from the top, causing death of central shoot, and such damage to the top portion leads to the drying up of these internodes at the top, which already are formed and they are wasted. In such case, okay, one or two buds just below the dry top portion sprout and develop into small sized side canes or side shoots, forming a bunchy top, that is a bushy appearance like this. Okay, so when the top shoot is damaged, you get the side shoots and a bunchy top appearance or bushy appearance is observed. Then the management practices for these borer complex, all three borers, and some more number of borers are there, but they are not in question in North India. Extra borers, they are endemic to those places and they are not observed in South India. So we are not dealing with them. First of all, what the activities are to be done? You have to collect and destroy the egg masses. Then late planting is to be done in case of early shoot borer. So if it is early shoot borer, you have to plant the crop late so you can escape the attack. Then trash mulching against the early shoot borer. So this is a big pest, or it is so problematic. The early shoot borer, it is keeping the crop low. Okay, it is not allowing the crop to grow up. Then pheromone traps, which are to be, means the specific ones, they are to be utilized for the borer complex, means we are including these borers, all borers. Then the dead hearts are to be removed, and along with that, whatever the larvae are present inside, they are also to be killed by drying them. Drying means to put them in fire, or you may utilize some chemicals to kill them. So you have to just dump or immerse those dead hearts in some chemical mixture in water. Okay, then early earthing up of canes should be done, usually a month after planting, which helps in minimizing the damage of early shoot borer and root borers. Timely planting of cane should be done in early in July, August, and in case of pre-seasonal, in October, suru in December, January. The clumps should be dug out, that is the stubbles that is left over after harvest, to kill the hibernating larvae of the root borers, early shoot and internode borers. Trash burning, practically it is not a for whole of the ecosystem, but what we have to do is the localized or topical treatment of burning the trash, as recommendations are there, that can be implemented to prevent the carryovers of the internode borer infestation to the succeeding crops. Then some biological control agents are to be utilized. The augmentative release is to be done of Sturmiopsis inference at 125 gravid females per hectare. Gravid females means those are the eggs there. Then fortnightly release of Trichogramma chelonis. We call this Trichogramma cards as trichocards per hectare from 30th day till 120th day, means 1 month to up to 4 months, and we should be utilizing this biocontrol agent trichocard or Trichogramma chelonis. Then the granulosis virus should be utilized at the rate of 250 LE, that is larval equivalent per hectare. Now regarding the chemical control, many new molecules of chemicals are introduced in the market. So the ones which have the label claim for sugarcane, they should be utilized, and many private players are having their activities for these insecticides. This is to be an assignment for you to find the label claims or the labels of every paste which is managed by the particular insecticide. And you should be having your activity of management with the value of ETL from 15% to 22% incidence in top shoot borer. So the ETL values are to be taken care for successful IPM. Now here the pheromone trap, how it is applied in the sugarcane crop. When it is a very tall crop, fourth or fifth month crop should be having 25 traps per hectare at suitable height with lure changes. Now you can see this trap, it is just near the shoot. Okay, when the shoot, or at the place where the shoot is ending, and the canes you can easily see. So you have the this pheromone trap can catch all these pests. Then the next one is white fly, or we call it as mealywings. Okay, so its scientific name Alurolobus barodensis or Neomascalia bergai, family Aluroidae, order Hemiptera. The importance is that it causes almost 26% loss in yield and 9% is sucrose, that we call it as our recovery, is seen. Then the host plant, only monophagous pest for or against sugarcane crop. So life history, egg laying and pupation is on the leaves, and the damage, all of you are acquainted with the order Hemiptera. Now the members of this order Hemiptera are bound to have piercing and sucking type of mouth parts. So if they are the members of order Hemiptera, they are bound to have piercing and sucking type of mouth part, and the damage will be done by the active stages, means the nymph and adult stage, which will pierce the cells or the body of the plant and suck the sap. And here these two stages, the nymphal stage and the adult stage, they are sucking the sap from the leaves, and the leaves, when infested in such a manner, they will turn yellow, they will dry, and the vigor of that crop will be affected. Speck like appearance will be seen, and indirect losses will also be observed, that they are secreting some substances, the dew like substances, honeydew like substances, that may lead to the infestation, or in micro scale you call it as infection due to or infection of the capnodium fungus, that is the black fungus, leading to the blackening or damage in the long term against, or it will hamper the photosynthesis. Then the management practice, so this is feeding on the leaves. So some leaves which are seen with greater infestation, they should be removed or clipped off, and destroying these leaves with in fire or in some systemic or other types of contact chemicals to kill the pest. Then spraying is advised with some systemic insecticides. The next pest is pyrrhela. So sugarcane pyrrhela, also called as leaf hopper, Pyrrhela purpusilla, family Fulgoridae, and order Hemiptera. So these are also the sucking pests, and simply will state that we have this pest attacking in its nymphal and adult stage. So it is going to suck the sap. Economic importance, losses up to 35% in yield, 2 to 5% in sucrose. And in case of a very huge attack or epidemic condition, nearly 50% decrease in recovery. So very mass scale attack will lead to a big loss. How are these pests or these pyrrhelae? The adults, they are straw colored, two pairs of wings folded like a roof on the back, head extended like a pointed beak. In the photograph you can see it properly. The nymphs, they are when they are newly hatched, they appear to be milky white with a pair of characteristic processes or filaments covered by wax on the posterior side. Very active, is they jump so swiftly you can't find it in where it lands in the second case or second leap. Very active and found in large numbers on the cane or underside of the leaves. So the host plants, almost all from gramini family, wheat, barley, jowar, maize, bajra, etc. life history, oviposition on the lower surface of leaves, and also between the detached leaf sheath and the stem, covered with white cottony waxy filaments. Incubation period 7 to 14 days in summer and 30 to 40 days in winter. And nymphal period 50 to 60 days in summer, so very, very long term. Okay, almost 2 months they are going to suck the sap from the canes or your crop, the leaves. Okay, and 50 to 80 days in winter. So winter is a very favorable period for these pests, sucking pests, and during winter they are going to cause a huge loss or huge damage to your crop almost for 3 months. So life cycle is completed in 60 days in summer and 120 days in winter. So very, very long period you are to face this pest in your crop with 3 to 5 generations per year. So this white structure that you can see is the nymph, okay? And the small spots you can see, they are the honeydew-like substances. They are released from the body, and those honeydew-like substances, they fall on the leaves beneath, and on the lower side, the lower photograph, you can see there are some black spots or black markings. That is nothing but the attack of Capnodium fungus, the black sooty mold, you may say, which will cover the leaf. The whole leaf is covered, you can see every leaf is covered beneath, and it is going to obstruct the sunlight. It is not allowing the sunlight to reach the chlorophyll or the leaf, and the photosynthesis is in danger or it is hampered. So this is from order Hemiptera. Both nymphs and adults suck the cell sap from the lower surface of the leaves. As a result, plant loses vigor and turgidity, begin to wither and get dried up. In the photograph, you can see this. Then the sucrose percentage of juice is adversely affected, and excretion of honeydew-like substance that spreads on the leaves, on which black fungus, I have explained this earlier, the Capnodium species, develop, adversely affects the photosynthesis, and yield is adversely affected. Management, how you can manage this: collect and destroy the egg masses, remove 5 to 6 lowermost leaves, helps in the reduction of Pyrrhella population as maximum egg laying takes place on such lower leaves. Biocontrol agent Epirikania melanoleuca is to be used at the rate 5000 cocoons per hectare. This is a nymphal parasitoid, and this Epirikania melanoleuca is from the order Lepidoptera. Then chemicals, systemic insecticides are to be utilized, and when you see 3 to 5 individual eggs or nymphs or adults per leaf, you should start the management practices. Aerial spraying is to be done. The next pest is sugarcane woolly aphid. Scientific name Ceratovacuna lanigera, MCGidae, order Hemiptera. Reduction in yield up to 8 metric tons per hectare. So calculate with the whatever the rate of sugarcane you have this year. Multiply it. If you are losing 8 metric tons per hectare, find or just think of how much loss you are incurring. Then 0.5% sugar recovery is also seen in loss. Then marks of identification: this is black in color when in as an adult, 2 pairs of transparent wings at posterior end of the abdomen, having a pair of cornicles on the fifth abdomen segment. Then nymphs, they are wingless. First and second instar nymphs do not have woolly filaments. First and second instar nymphs do not have woolly filaments. The woolly filament is observed in third and fourth instar, and host plants are generally sugarcane, then Cynodon dactylon, that is the dub grass, or you call it as Hariyali, bamboo. So life history: the adults emerge after fourth molt. The female reproduce parthenogenetically,
How? Parthenogenetically means they are reproducing without fertilization throughout the year, and the nymphal stage is from 6 to 22 days and life cycle is completed in 30 days. So for a month they are going to feed on your crop. They are going to suck the sap. Who? The nymphs and adults. They are sucking the sap from the lower surface of the leaves. So they are also protecting themselves against the solar radiation. Then the nymphs and adults continue to feed, and then they are releasing the honeydew-like substance which falls on the lower leaves, as seen in case of the sugarcane pyrrhella. Then the honeydew-like substance, it will have the attack of capnodium fungus, photosynthesis is affected, and these leaves, they are not going to produce more photosynthesis, and the losses in the sugarcane crop are seen. So keep pair row with wider spacing, so you can have some distance between two rows. Then selection of seed material from the pest free area. This is very important fact for most of the pests. This is the IPM practice in your legal as well as cultural method. Then timely earthing up should be done in case of sugarcane woolia feed. Then removing the trash and crop residues after harvesting, that is clean cultivation should be seen or observed. Then the varieties that are susceptible should be avoided. This is a big part. And next, the biocontrol agents that we are using are Chrysoparla carnea, Diphafidivora. Okay, there are rates of applications varying. So Chrysoparla at 2500 eggs or larvae per hectare, Diphafidivora is a Lepidopterous predator. It should be also used. Then chemical control, the systemic insecticides are to be used, or you may also dust the methyl parathion powder. Then the mealybugs. Now this is also a sucking pest, scientific name Sachariococcus sachari, family Pseudococcidae, order Hemiptera. So order is Hemiptera, and it is going to suck the sap. So piercing and sucking type of mouth part is seen. Then losses up to 55% in yield. So if your yield is 100 tons per hectare, you are going to get only 50 tons and less than that per hectare, means only 55 tons. Got this? So this is the extent of damage this pest is doing to your crop. Then the host plants, sorghum and grasses, along with sugarcane. Life history, the eggs are laid on the nodal region. Nature of damage, these nymphs and adults of mealybug, they are found in large numbers. They are sucking the sap, and they are sucking the sap from the nodal region and in the leaf sheath. It is a vector of the disease mottling and spike in sugarcane. Okay, mottling and spike disease of sugarcane is transmitted by mealybug. Then the management practices that you have to take up are use of systemic insecticide like imidacloprid at the rate 25 gram active ingredient per hectare, or thimethoxam 70 wg or sp at the rate 25 grams active ingredient per hectare. So how you can prepare it? 36 grams, that product is taken in 150 liters of water, and this is for set treatment. You have to dip the sets, okay, the planting material, you have to dip in this solution, and then you have to use it for planting. Then you are also to spray with some systemic insecticides like imidacloprid or dimethoate, malathion, phosphamidon, etc. The next is the scale insect, scientific name Melanaspis glomerata, order Hemiptera, family Diaspididae. So Now also you can say the paste is from Hemiptera order and it is going to suck the sap in its nymphal and adult stage. This is a simple logic. Keep always in this in mind from your second semester, whatever you have learned regarding the morphology and systematics, you have to link the systematics with its morphology and then you can easily explain the paste. Here you can say the host plants, it is monophagous paste. Monophagous means it is attacking only the sugarcane crop. Nymphs, in case of the females, they are laying the eggs and later on all those eggs means they are also reproducing viviparously, means the eggs hatch inside the body itself and within some time period they are laying those young ones from their body. They are expelling those young ones from their body after they hatch inside their body only. Then the nymphs that hatch out from the egg within the female's body come out through the genital aperture. They are called as crawlers. They settle after selecting suitable site for feeding. Then what the adults are, the female is slightly convex, smoky brown to grayish black, irregularly circular. As in the photograph you can see how their structure is, they are circular. They cover the nodal region forming a thick encrustation and the attack on the cane, you can see how they have covered the cane. The male scale is similar to female but much smaller and much oval. Okay, male scale is similar to female but the males are smaller and they are oval in shape. This is identification. Good mark of identification. They are small and oval and females are larger and circular or round. Then nature of damage, as we have discussed earlier, this is the member of order Hemiptera. So the nymphs and adults will suck the cell sap from the canes, and when they are sucking the sap from the canes are going to get shriveled. Okay, means they are losing their turgidity. The cane, which is healthy one, it is turgid one. You may say its appearance is rich and vigorous, but those attacked or infested by the scales, they are shriveled. Okay, and they may or they can be seen as dried ones with reduced internodes. How you can manage? You have to detrash or strip off the trash from the canes and the areas where the scales are attacking more. This activity should be done in that topical or as a topical treatment. Then the set treatments with systemic insecticides like diamethoate 30 EC for 15 minutes before planting. You have to dip these sets in the insecticides and then you have to use it for planting. Biocontrol agents like Incarcia, Aphytis and Coccophagus lichani are to be used against this scale insect. Our next pest is termite. Okay, the termites, scientific name Odontotermis obesus. Up till now we completed our sucking pest complex. Now here you can have the termites, which is direct pest in the soil itself, and also it can attack the foliar body or the leaves of sugarcane. The family Termitidae, order Isoptera. Now here in the photograph itself, I'll get your attention how its social classification is. So you have a queen, the king, then these queens and kings from the Termitoria, they get themselves the wings. Okay, the queen and the king, they get the wings when there is rainfall. So the first few showers of monsoon will lead to their outgrowth of wings. Then that is going to cause, or that is going to help them to get the nuptial flight, and the king and the queen, they will mate and later on lay the eggs. Those eggs will be producing the workers
and the soldiers from those eggs. Okay, simply this is the explanation regarding their social polymorphism. Their economic importance: they are polyphagous insects. Their infestation is seen in light soils or sandy loam soils, and serious damage is seen in unirrigated areas. These termites, they are very, very quick wherever they get some moisture in dry land areas. They go and find their food quickly, and they are going to feed on dead and decaying material. Again, marks of identification: social insects, they are having polymorphic forms. As I told you earlier, the queen, the king, the workers and soldiers living in colony. They live in underground nests, make small earthen mounds or earthen passages that are visible above the ground. On opening a portion of a passage, grayish white wingless insects are seen moving. So these grayish white wingless insects, they are the workers. Okay, the king and the queen, they are deep inside in the central hall, you may say. They are not moving outside at the periphery. So the host plants, so these are the polyphagous pairs, means they are having multiples of hosts. They are attacking wheat, sugarcane, groundnut, cotton, chilies, brinjal, fruit trees, etc., as well as many other crops which may fall prey to these termites. So the life history: when the first monsoon shower appears, you can see here winged adult. The sexual forms leave their colony for nuptial flight. During evening, mate and latter shed their wings. The sexual form means the queen and the king. They are going to fly some distant place, okay, and they are going to mate. The queen and king settle down and burrow in the soil, and later on the female is laying the eggs. You can see the potential egg laying capacity or this prolificacy. It lays up to 7,000 to 80,000 eggs per day, that is within 24 hours. The calculation, if you have, it is going to yield or it is going to. Then there is only one queen in a colony that lives for 5 to 10 years or beyond it. Later on, the incubation period is 1 week. In summer, and within 6 months, larvae develops to form soldiers or worker. The reproductive cast mature in 1 to 2 years. A pair of fertile casts, that is king and queen, always are present in the royal chamber of the termitoria. What is this termitoria? Termitoria is the mound and the where these termites are living. You can see the different damage symptoms here. In sugarcane, what you can see, the workers, they are going to damage the crop. These workers of termites, they are feeding on the roots and stem of the plants that ultimately dries the plant. Then the entire shoot dries up and can be pulled out easily. The sets are hollow inside. You can see how they are, these sets in the soil. They are hollow inside and may be filled with soil. Means there is transport continuously done by these termites in the sets. They carry the soil. Then the cane collapses if it is disturbed, means that it is dried one, and the rind is filled with mud. Characteristic semicircular feeding marks on the leaves in the standing crop. Some semicircular feeding marks are seen. They are cut. The leaves are cut in semicircular form. You can say that is the attack of termites. Other forms do not cause any direct damage, means only the workers, they are damaging. Okay, the workers are damaging in case of termites. Soldiers, the king and the queen, they are not having a direct damage on our crop. Indirectly they are damaging. Soldiers, they have a very very bad bite, so irritating bite to the human beings or anybody who is encroaching. And the king and queen, they are busy with laying the eggs or multiplying or reproducing. And here the sugarcane crop, you can see inside the stem, the attack by the termites, they are filling the gaps with soil also eating away the inner part. So management practices, long lease is there. So you have to find the termitoria, destroy the queen by digging out the termitoria. You should be using some fumigants like CS2, methyl bromide, or CS2 plus chloroform mixture at the rate 250 ml per mound. As per the size of the mound, you can use it. These are the fumigants. Then stubbles of the previous crops and other dead decaying matter should be removed, since they attract termites, because the termites are feeding. You call them simply as sarcophagus. Okay, they are feeding on the dead material. Then care should be taken not to use green manure or raw farmyard manure to avoid the attack. So that manure should be very well decomposed. Then destroy the affected sets from the field. Affected sets from the field are to be carried away. They should be destroyed by burning, or you may have them treated with some insecticide. Treat the sets with imidacloprid. Then aerial spraying of chlorantraniliprole or imidacloprid is advocated there, means they have been referred. Then termite damage in standing crop can be minimized by application of chlorpyrifos in irrigation water, or field spreading of chlorpyrifos 20 c mixed with sand or soil. Also dusting is also seen or found good. Keep the crop healthy and vigorous. Shortage of water leading to initial drying of plant may lead to termite infestation. Help it, hence it is very necessary to keep the crop healthy and vigorous. And in case of biological control, some research from the scientists at Assam Agriculture University, they have presented some papers regarding the management of termites using these fungus. Okay, so the verticillium, maybe some metrizium, they are also utilizing Bavaria. They are having some trials done. Okay, so they are managing these termites in the mounds very, very effectively. So try to find out such research activities for managing this pest. Then in new plantations, the pits should be treated with methyl pyrethione dust before planting the trees. Now white grub, holotrachia, consanguinea, here three species are there generally that have been observed. Two are there, holotrachia is there, and some more, means they are from the river basins. Then family Scarabidae, order Coleoptera. Distribution and status, it is distributed throughout the country, throughout India. Host strains, sorghum, maize, pearl millet, chilies, bhindi, and brinjal. So the eggs are laid by the female, means 27 eggs in soil on an average, that are pear shaped and enclosed in earthen cells. The grub is fleshy, it is C-type or C-shaped, and it is whitish yellow in color, found close to the base of the clump, means in the soil itself, in sugarcane plot only. Then the pupae, they are tan to brown and occur deeper in the soil in earthen chambers. The adult beetles are a rusty red color just after emerging from pupal stage, but turn nearly black, attracted to neem tree in monsoon season. When the monsoon appears, first some showers of monsoon are there. These adults, which are hiding inside the soil, they are emerging. The males and females, they will emerge. They will feed on the leaves of neem tree. And during the evening time itself, in the evening time, they are feeding on the neem leaves, some bare leaves. And later on, they mate. And after mating, the females, they will enter the soil and they will lay the eggs wherever it finds good food. So you can see this as an opportunity, that the grubs, they are hiding in the soil. You can't manage the grubs easily in the soil, but you have to take the benefit when the adults, they are emerging. When the adults emerge, when they are feeding on the leaves or on the trees, you should be trapping them at that place only, or killing them at that place only. So that will help or reduce the tedious activity, or your toil is to be lessened there. Your efforts are to be reduced.
So nature of damage, what it is going to do, the grubs, they are feeding on the live roots. It is not sarcophagus, or it is not feeding on dead material, but it is directly feeding on the live roots, causing extensive damage to the roots. Due to this, if the roots are lost, the yellowing and wilting of leaves is seen, because when the crop is losing its feeding mechanism in the soil, ultimately the aerial shoot is to be damaged, followed by drying of the crown. Affected canes come up easily when pulled. So when the root system is damaged, then it is to be losing its foothold in the soil. Then the affected canes shows lodging in field. They may fall off. Okay, this crop is lodged. Then damages can be seen more in ratoon crop, because you can't manage it in the early stage. You have early food present there. In the new crop, the root system is not that much good, and this pest can't have its prolificacy expressed in this crop. So you can say during the ratoon crop, it gets ample of food there, and it is going to keep itself present, and it is going to damage your crop. You can see the losses, how the crop is lost in every photograph. So these are the adders which are feeding on the leaves of neem. So how you are managing them? Okay, regularly monitor the field for signs of white grubs and beetles. If the leaves of neem tree, they are found or seen fed or they are reduced, you can say that you have a good population of these white grubs. Provide adequate irrigation, or flooding is also a good method for killing the young ones or the larval stages inside the soil. Then deep plowing immediately after the harvest of the crop to expose the pupae as well as these adults in the soil. And if case is there, the eggs also. But in summers, there are no eggs. The adults, they are hiding. The pupae, they are hibernating. Then avoid ratoon cropping. So ratoon crops should be avoided in the places where you have more infestation. Okay, that may not be economical to kill off all the crop or not having a ratoon crop. Then stagnating water for 24 hours in the field, then the grub will come out from the soil. You have to kill it, or you may utilize some biological control agent like the different fungus. Then one activity of social or you may say the mass management of this white grub is that in recent period we had a big infestation of white grubs in many areas due to the extended, or you may say the dry spell of monsoon or the rains. So the grubs, they started damaging, or before they start damaging, there was a mass scale management wherein some sugar factories were involved, some other institutes were involved, and they gave the advisories. People collected these adults. You may see on the table, there is a heap of adults of white grub. So these white grubs, they are collected. One of our ex-students is also involved in that activity. In the photograph, he can't be depicted right now. So the physical method, campaign to collect and destroy the adult beetles harboring in nearby neem, ailanthus and acacia trees immediately after the summer showers using powerful Petromax lights. Okay, lights you have to use, or such light traps are to be prepared. If it is solar light, then it is well and good. It will be a eco-friendly activity again as a mass campaign in area near to the forest and hilly regions where the infestation can be seen. So applying some biocontrol agents like Bivaria bassiana, Bivaria browniorti at 2.5 kg per hectare. The count should be 1 into 10 raised to 9 colony forming units. The CFU is colony forming units per gram. These are the entomopathogenic fungi, or the fungus. These formulations, they are acting, or they are to be present in the soil, which will be, or which should be mixed with some FOIM or compost and then applied in the soil. And while you are
some fungus, you should take care suitable and compatible methods are to be used in field at the time of planting. You should use all these management practices in the places where there are these pests. So entomopathogenic nematodes, EPNs, are also to be used for managing these wild grubs. So this is all about your management of pests in sugarcane. So let's stop here. Have a good day.